ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। Read from Srimad Bhagavad Gita, 10th chapter, text 32. Sarganam Adir Antas Cha Madhyam Jaivaham Arjuna Adhyatma Vidya Adhyatma Vidya Vidyanam Vata Prabhadatam Aham Sarganam Adirantascha. Sarganam Adirantascha. Madhyam Chaivaham Arjuna. Adhyatma Vidya Vidyanam. Vata Pravadatam Aham. Sarganam Adirantascha. Adhyam Chaivaham Arjuna Adhyatma Vidya Vidyanam Vata Pravata Tam Alam Vata Pravata Tam Aham. Sarganam Adirantascha. Arjuna. Adhyatma Vidya Vidyanam. Vada Pravatam Aham. Nam Adivadasa. Adhyam Chaivaham Arjuna. Adhyatma Vidya Vidyanam Vata Pravadatam Aham. Sarganam Adirantascha Madhyam Chaivaham Arjuna. Vidyanam Sarganam Adirantascha Madhyam Chaivaham Arjuna. Vidyanam Vata Pravadatam Aham. Sarganam of all creations, Adi the beginning, Anta and Cha and Madhyam, middle. Cha, also. Eva, certainly. Aham, I am. Arjuna, O Arjuna. Adhyatma Vidya, spiritual knowledge. Vidyanam, of all education. Vada, the natural conclusion. Pravadatam, of arguments. Aham, I am. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Of all creations, I am the beginning and the end and also the middle. O Arjuna. Of all sciences, I am the spiritual science of the self, and among logicians, I am the conclusive truth. Purport. Among the created manifestations, the first is the creation of the total material elements. As explained before, the cosmic manifestation is created and conducted by Mahavishnu, Garbhodakshayi Vishnu and Kshirodakshayi Vishnu. And then again, it is annihilated by Lord Shiva. Brahma is the secondary creator. All these agents of creation, maintenance, and annihilation are incarnations of the material qualities of the Supreme Lord. Therefore, he is the beginning, the middle, and the end of all creation. For advanced education, there are various kinds of books of knowledge, such as the four Vedas, their six supplements, the Vedanta Sutra, books of logic, books of religiosity, and the Puranas. So altogether, there are 14 divisions of books of education. Of these, the book which presents Adhyatma Vidya, spiritual knowledge, in particular the Vedanta Sutra, represents Krishna. Among logicians, there are different kinds of arguments. Supporting one's argument with evidence that also supports the opposing side is called Jalpa. Merely trying to defeat one's opponent is called Pitanda, but the actual conclusion is called Vada. This conclusive truth is a representation of Krishna. Sarganam adhir antascha madhyam chaivaham arjuna adhyatma vidya vidyanam vada pravadatam aham. Of all creations I am the beginning and the end, and also the middle, O Arjuna. Of all sciences I am the spiritual science of the self, and among logicians I am the conclusive truth, vada. Om Agyati Maranyasya Gananchana Salakyam Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasma Shikrave Namaha Se Chaitanya Mano Vistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Kadamayam Tadati Svapadantikam Vanchakalpa Trupyascha Kripa Sindhyapevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Vande Sri Krishna Chaitanya Nityananda Sahoditao Gaudataya Pushpavanto Chitta Shanto Tamunadao. He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabando Chagapate Gopicha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gorangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Rishabhanu Sutta Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vrindai Tulsi Devai Priye Kisvasya Cha Krishna Bhakti Vrata Devi Satya Vatya Namo Namaha Chai Si Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nittananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Chvasadi Gora Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Ram Ram Hare Hare Srimad Bhagavad Gita Ki Jai. Svayam Gre Srila Prabhupada Ki. Sarganam Adhirantascha Madhyam Chaivaham Arjuna Adhyatma Vidya Vidyanam Vada Pravada Tam Aham. So here Krishna explains further to Arjuna his Vibhutis. This chapter is called Vibhuti Yoga, the yoga of the supreme opulences of the Lord who are represented in this material world. So this material world is not an independent machinery, like a machine. It has a creator, and because everything comes from consciousness, from supreme consciousness, super consciousness, and that's Krishna, Ishvara Parama. Krishna Satchitananda Vigraha Anadi Adi Govinda Sarva Karana Karanam. Sarva Karana Karanam. So Brahma Samhita very clearly states that Govinda or Krishna is Adi Purusham and he is Sarva Karana Karanam. He is the cause of all causes. So it is Krishna who is the original cause of all causes. The Purushas mentioned here by Srila Prabhupada in the purport, who are actually in relation with the material nature for the creation and for the maintenance and annihilation. These Purushas their plenary expansion of an expansion of an expansion of Lord Krishna, of the Govindam Adipurusham, Tamaham Bhajami. So Krishna is the origin. His first expansion is Balaram, Sankarshan, then quadruple Chaturvyuha becomes manifest in the Goloka, then the Chaturvyuha second becomes manifested in the Vaikuntas, and then from the Sankarshan of the Vaikunta, second Sankarshan, the Purushas become manifest. That means Mahavishnu, Garbhadakshay Vishnu, and Kshiradakshay Vishnu, and also the support of universe, Anantashesh. These are all manifestations of Sankarshan. And Sankarshan is Balaram. Balaram is the first expansion of Krishna. He's not different from Krishna, but still Krishna is considered the original. He's the origin of everything. That means ultimately it is Krishna through whom everyone else is acting. Is the original cause of all causes. Although all Vishnus are eternal, Vishnu Tattva is eternal, they're always Vishnu Tattva. It's not that they're changing Tattva, they remain always in that Tattva eternally. Although Krishna is the origin, they're also simultaneously existing since time immemorial for the sake of the Leela in the spiritual world, and also for the manifestation in the material world. So in the material world, it's not necessarily needed for the enjoyment of the Lord, because the Lord is always enjoying with his devotees, with his eternal associates in the spiritual world, in the various spiritual planets, Paravyoma, and in the Goloka planets, the universe of the spiritual world. So the material world is for those who are want to enjoy independently of the Lord. And for them, the Purushas manifested this material energy. So therefore, it is the Purusha, Krishna, who is Mahavishnu, who is manifesting, who is the beginning of the universe. Therefore, it is stated in Upanishads, in the beginning, there was no Brahma, there was no Shankara, there was no Shiva, there was no demigods, no manifestations, only I existed. That means only the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Mahapurusha, he existed at the beginning of the creation. And from him, when the time came, that he was breathing out, then the universes all became manifested through the breathing process of Mahavishnu. And then they are maintained by the different avatars and by the super soul, Kshiradakshay Vishnu, who is in everyone's heart. So the universe is maintained. Is also maintained by the different representatives of the Lord, the demigods who are representing certain powers of Krishna. They all remain in the universal form of the Virat Purusha, like Indra represents the universal form's arms. The sun, Surya represents the eyes, the mind represents the moon represents the mind of the universal form. Ashwini Kumara's the smelling process, the breathing process of the universal form, the nostrils, the nose. Vayu, the skin. Now I also feel skin, how you can feel fresh sensation in the skin because of the air. So the deity in charge for the sensual perception is air, Vayu. It's also manifested from the universal form. That means all the principal demigods, 33 or 33 million accordingly, they are all attained inside of this universal form. So that's besides the universal form, nothing is existing in this universe. There's nothing else. Everything, the lower planets, the middle planets, the higher planets, all the different vegetations, the animals, certain animals, they became manifested from the Lord, from his nails, from different vegetation, from his bodily hair. That's all described in the Srimad Bhagavatam in the second canto and the third canto. This very elaborate description of the universal form, how actually everything is included or contained in the universal form, and this universal form is a manifestation of the Purusha, Garbhodakshay Vishnu, who is a manifestation of Mahavishnu, and Mahavishnu comes from Narayana, and ultimately everything comes from Krishna. So therefore Krishna says, I'm the beginning, I'm the Svarga. The first creation of Purusha is known as Svarga. And the second creation of Brahma, who is practically like the engineer, how to manifest and build up this universe with the 14 planetary systems, according to the karma of all the living entities who are not born yet, but who will be born in the future, by the Lord's arrangement. 1/4 of all living entities are taking birth. But this is already stated in the text 20 of the 10th chapter, where Krishna says, I'm the beginning, I'm the middle, and the end of all the living entities. That means of the jivas. But here, Krishna says, I am the beginning, middle, and end of the material manifestation of Svarga. It has nothing to do with the living entities. Living entities already mentioned. Krishna doesn't repeat himself at this point. He already mentioned that in connection or in relation with the jivas. That is the beginning. He is the beginning when the living entities are taking birth. He's also the middle in the life of the, and always guides the living entity from one body to another. And also the end, changing death. Janma mritu chara vyadi dukkha dosha na darshanam. Or as Krishna says, I'm dead. I'm the time. Actually, this material universe is manifested due to Kala. And Kala is a time aspect coming from the Lord. It's a representation of the Lord. The time is not independent of the Lord. But the Lord himself is not influenced by time. But everyone who takes birth in the material world, and all the creation in this material world, becomes manifested due to the influence of the time. And from where everything is coming from? From the gigantic body of Mahavishnu. And when the time of creation is manifested, or this time that it will become manifested, a big cloud will appear, the Mahatattva. And in the Mahatattva is the combined sum total of all the 24 elements, earth, water, fire, air, ether, mind, intelligence, false ego, the five active senses, the five knowledge acquiring senses, the Mahatattva itself. So they are all in total 24 elements, and the 25th element is the Jiva, and the 26th element ultimately is the Paramatma. Between these 24, the material energy is actually inactive, it's Prakriti. When material nature from avyakta, from the Mahavishnu's body becomes manifested, or it's unmanifest, it's called avyakta, or avyakta. What's the other name? Avyakta stage. And if the material nature from the avyakta stage becomes manifest, then it's called prakriti. Prakriti. And prakriti, it's a material energy combined. And it first appears in form of the mahatattva. And only when Lord Mahavishnu is glancing over that cloud of the mahatattva, all these elements start to come to move. That means without the presence of the soul and the supersoul, Atma, the material energy cannot progress, it cannot evolutionize itself, because that matter has no life. So only because of the presence of the spiritual energy, Chichakti, of the Lord, means living entity, and the Lord who is in the heart of the living entity, the material universe becomes alive. And that is considered the beginning. The beginning of the material creation of the Mahatattva, and then from Mahatattva, the false ego becomes manifest. Therefore, that's the problem number one what we have, false ego, ahankara. Everyone from the top planet to the everyone is occupied by the false conception, I'm this body, I am the enjoyer, I'm the controller. Ishvara Hambogi. This materialistic mentality is very predominant in the confused, materially illusioned or conditioned living entity. So he forgets his real identity, that I'm eternal servant of Krishna, and instead he accepts position that I'm the body. I'm Indian, I'm American, I'm German, I'm Swiss, I'm whatever. So this is our illusion, that's ahankara. And everyone has a certain ahankara concept. And ahankara has three aspects according to the modes of material nature. Sattva-guna, tamaguna, rajaguna. So from ahankara, from sattva-guna, the mind becomes manifest, from ahankara of rajaguna, intelligence become manifest. Therefore everyone needs intelligence if he wants to be creative and develop something in this world. Needs good intelligence, that means it's on the mode of passion. The mind likes more peacefulness, become thoughtful and absorbed in himself. Doesn't express himself outside so much. That's only because of the intelligence and because of the senses. Who represent the mode of ignorance. The senses and the body, they're manifested from ahankara of the mode of ignorance, tamaguna. Therefore the living entity is embodied or encaged in the three kinds of ahankaras, in the mode of goodness, passion and ignorance. And because although everything originally comes from goodness or transcendence, because we become influenced of the modes of material nature, daivishagunamai mama maya turatya, mameivaya prabhatyante mayamitam tarantite. So it's difficult to come out of this maya, because this maya is conditioning the living entity. It binds it. Bandaha. The guna means rope, it blinds the living entity to material conditioning and accepting different conceptions of life. And as long as we are in these different conceptions of life, material universe will go on, and we go to different stages of beginning, Adi, Madhya and Antya. Again and again and again and again. It's repeating again and again. Adi, Madhya, Antya. everything has a beginning, a middle, and an end in this material world. In the spiritual world, there's no beginning, therefore also no middle, and also no end, and also no time influence. Time influence is destructive ultimately, because it causes the destruction of the material created bodies in a big way, universal body, or little tiny body, or a human body. A body will, according to time, after some time will fall apart. It will has an antya. But Krishna says the spiritual world has no antya. It's anantya. It's spiritual world is ananta, it's unending. It has no beginning and no end. And for the spiritual world and the Lord Himself is ananta. But in the material world, everyone is ananta, has a beginning and an end. Everything that has a beginning will have an end. So therefore, in the material world had a beginning, therefore it has an end. And the living entity takes birth and has a beginning in a certain body, has a medium stage, and then ultimately the death is coming. But for the soul, there's no end. Actually, for nothing is an end. Even for the material elements, for the material creation, it is repeating again and again. The energy always remains, always just takes different forms. But the living entity always stays the same, because we are eternal part and parcel of the Supreme Lord. Nitya nityanam chetanas chetananam ekobahonam yovidatati kaman. So we're all nitya. The material world is anitya. It is temporary, because it has beginning and end. Therefore, only out of illusion of we become conditioned by the transformation of the material energy. The jiva doesn't transform. God Himself is not transforming. Only the material energy is transforming. They go through vikara. They have transformation. But the spiritual energy that never transforms, because it eternally remains always the same. And that is actually that what we have to realize. And that is real education, as Krishna says. Vidya, the real vidya, education, is to understand we're eternal. Atma is eternal. The material creation, either in universal creation or the individual body creation, is temporary. It has a beginning, middle, and an end. But the Atma Vidya has no beginning, no end. And therefore, real education is to learn and to understand from the guru or from teacher and from Shastra that we're eternal, and that we're not eternal voidness or just the blissful light without purpose, but that we're eternal servant of Krishna. This is our identity. And this is therefore needed, that the people become educated by Atma Vidya. Now the whole world is educated in avidya, in ignorance. And because out of ignorance we are accepting so many different kinds of anattas, so many bad habits. Actually, four kinds of anattas the conditioned soul is influenced by. First one is called asatrishna. Asatrishna means the contemplation of sense objects, to enjoy. I'm the enjoyer, enjoying the material facility of the temporary world as much as possible. It's called asatrishna. Asat means temporary. Trishna means contemplation. Contemplating the temporary object with the purpose to enjoy it. So that's the first anatta of the conditioned soul, asatrishna. Second anatta is ridaya daubalyam. You heard also Krishna chastise Arjuna in the beginning, in the second chapter. Oh, you are not fighting, you are a miser. Out of weakness, ridaya daubalyam. You don't have the determination to fight and to perform your duty, execute your duty. So Ridaya Darbalyam means weakness of the heart out of a doubt. Weakness comes from doubt. Doubt is, we are not clear. We are doubtful because we are not clear about our real identity, about goal of life, mission of life. We are not convinced, or we are doubtful about our functioning or our duties. And therefore, this anatta, who is existing since time immemorial, this ridaya darbalyam, this weakness of the heart, as long we are in this maintaining and cultivating this weakness, we remain weak. We become very lethargic, very spoiled, and practically fully surrendered to this maya and to the life of Asat Krishna, of easy enjoyment in this world in one way or another. We take it because we want to enjoy. Living entity wants to enjoy. It's ananda maya abhyasat. We want to enjoy, but in material world there's no eternal enjoyment. But therefore we become crazy. Where is enjoyment? Where is enjoyment? Where is enjoyment? And even if we cannot enjoy anymore, you know, then still we are hankering for it. One time, one king asked one brahmana, his minister, how long attraction to sex life exists or remains? Will it go away in old age? He says, no, it will stay up till an end of life. Oh, what to do? I cannot believe it. So then the minister brought the king to one citizen to his house, and he told the king, you bring your princess with you, and then you look what the dying man is focused on. And then when the king entered, the dying man, he didn't saw the king entering, he only saw the beautiful princess. And then he understood, you are right. Even in the time of death, the attraction to sex and to opposite sex is still remaining. It's practically not possible to give it up. And so therefore, this weakness of the heart, this ridaya darbalyam, it's an anatta, but is cultivated like a disease since time immemorial. And as long as we don't cure this disease, by taking proper treatment, Asat Trishna and Ridaya Daubalyam will not disappear on its own. It will only remain and become even more strong. Nunam Pramata Kuru Devi Karma. Actually, material sense gratification makes you completely mad, makes you blind for sense gratification. Because why? Nunam Pramata. Kuru Devi Karma, Yad Indriya Prataya Aprinoti, Na Sadhumanya Yata Atmanoyam, Asan Apiklesha Asha Deha. He doesn't see his ultimate destruction. He doesn't see the misery. And although he sees misery, he still thinks, oh, let's try again. Let's go on chewing the jute again and again. So that this is the conditioning of the material, world. It binds us more and more, and we cannot learn. Natevidu svarta katim hi Vishnu. So those who have no attraction to Vishnu or Krishna, they cannot come out of their ignorance, of their anartas. So anartas can only become overcome by surrendering to Krishna and to transcendental knowledge. Like Rishabhadev says, the intelligent person therefore should not imitate the weakness of the materialist to try to enjoy that what is already chewed. Na sadhu manye yata atmanoyam asan apiklesha asha deha. Knowing very well that these kind of activities will only lead to greater kleshas, greater misery. So cultivating of nations creates only more nations. So we cannot overcome nations or tamaguna by cultivation of tamaguna in the name of vidya. Ishapanishad says, those who are teaching avidya as knowledge, they fall down to the greatest hell, tamasa, to the greatest hell. They're falling down. So we should never consider ourselves great teachers of something if we're actually teaching nations or ignorance, because ignorance always leads to klesha, adiatmika klesha, adibautika klesha, and adidaivika klesha. Three kinds of kleshas are unavoidable in this material world, and therefore the education that only cultivates nations, that means tamaguna, that means materialistic life side, based on tama and rajas, will bind us more and more up, and we have to suffer again and again. Therefore, Rishabhadev says, intelligent person should therefore not engage in nations activities, in ignorant activities, but we should follow the process given by the Mahajans, by the devotees. Mahatsevam dvaram ahor vimukte tamo dvaram yoshita sangi sangam. Because if we associate with the asat, it will lead to hell. And if we lead and associate, and if we associate with sadhu sangha, satsanga, that will open the gateway to the spiritual world. Mahatsevam, service to the Mahat, will open the gateway. Mahatsevam dvaram. Dvara means the gate. Ahor vimukte, to liberation. That means spiritual world, entering into eternal pastimes of the Lord. So therefore, transcendental knowledge to overcome asa trishna and the weakness of the heart, to become dritavrata, we need dritavrata. We have to become very determined. And determination we can only get by sadhu sangha. That means with determined devotees, with realized devotees, with devotees, sadhakas who are experienced in the process of sadhana bhakti, who are determined in this process, in hearing, chanting, remembering Krishna, serving Krishna. And by association with them, we also can develop this quality. Sadhu sangha, sadhu sangha, sarva shastra koi, lava matra sadhu sangha, sarva siddhi hoi. So therefore, only one moment of sadhu, Lord Chaitanya told or mentioned, will deliver one from the greatest dangers. It will lead us to the supreme perfection. So only by association of devotees, following the liberated process of bhakti yoga, one will develop positive qualities. Not anartha, artadham, paramartadham, supreme occupational duties or qualities or duties, activities will become manifested. Habits, we all need habits. We cannot live without habit. We have maybe one habit now cultivated since long time, and I always meditate and work very hard on it, how to give it up, how to get rid of this habit. But what you will do if you get rid of the habit, you need another habit. But we need positive spiritual habits. Now we have so many ugly habits maybe, or so many habits in the material world based on the bodily conception of life. And this can be replaced just by developing spiritual habits through sadhana bhakti. Like an example is given. If you are poisoned by some mercury, how you can cure yourself of mercury poisoning? You have to take a small quantity of mercury. It's an
you have to get the doctor has to inject in you. Or like a snake bite. How you can counteract a snake bite? With the poison of a snake. You can counteract the mercury by small mercury poisoning, giving the patient a small amount of mercury. What I understood from Prabhupada, when he was very sick here, you know, the doctor also gave him mercury. Prabhupada knew about that. But it was not that the doctor wanted to poison Prabhupada. He gave him this as a medicine, so that he that his body become more strong. He can counteract that poisoning or that toxin that the body accumulated in the body. And now the question maybe comes up: why an acharya or a pure devotee develops a disease? Is this a disease like ordinary disease of an ordinary person? Because in material world, everyone gets diseased. Acharyas give also an example. And Krishna gives a pure devotee this disease to first of all, make the devotee more fired up, especially in the conditioned stage. That we become more fired up to serve Krishna, to surrender unto Him. But for a pure devotee who is always surrendered to Him, why he gets disease? Why Krishna gives him this or grants him this disease? To show that even a pure acharya or a pure devotee, even if he goes through diseases, he doesn't give up Krishna consciousness and his sadhana and his practice. He even becomes even more steady. And always remains fixed. He doesn't become an atheist because of disease. Some become atheists. They say, "Oh, my God, I'm devoted for so many lifetimes, or this person for so many years, he devoted and did so many, gave so many donations, distributed so many books, chanted so many times japa, so many holy names, worshipped so nicely the deity. Why he gets that?" I don't believe that God existing, or that if He is existing, He's very, unintelligent, partial. Some He gives and somebody doesn't give. Somebody can live very sinful life and becomes 106 years old. Is a very great devotee, fully surrendered, only lives maybe 40, 50 years old, like many of our acharyas and great devotees. Lord Chaitanya remained 48 years. Vallabhacharya, 52 or something. Saratana Goswami, maybe 70 or something. Shankaracharya, something over 30 years. 34 or something like that. So, but you can see, it's not the age. It's the time that how the acharya or the pure devotee is using it. Shukadev Goswami says, by every sunrise and sunset, the lifespan becomes shortened. Actually, Shauna Karishi, he told. But the one who is engaging in devotional service, his day is never lost. His time is never lost. Otherwise, it's always lost. If you're not engaging in Krishna service, every minute is lost. And if you're engaging in Krishna service, every minute is a victory. Then even if disease is there, the devotee is accepting it. To show to the materialist and to the jnani who claim, we cannot become free of material existence without going through our karma. So a devotee is accepting the karma, so-called karma, to show, okay, I give you a right, we go through our karma, but actually it is not the karma of sinful reactions from past life, from other lives, because a pure devotee has no karma from previous life. If a devotee has he accepts a certain karma because he wants to serve Krishna. But this is Krishna karma. It's Krishna's desire. And therefore Krishna, he lets the pure devotee go through certain difficulties in life, struggling, diseases, also difficulty in spreading the mission or devotional service. But this is never a handicap. It's never something that stops the devotee or the flow of bhakti. In contrary, it increases it more and more. Because pure bhakti can never stop. Material life has beginning and end, but bhakti has no beginning and end. Bhakti is nitya siddha. It is eternal, it is perfect. It's not something that we can pay for or we can work for to develop bhakti. Bhakti comes by Krishna's grace, by bhakti devi grace. Not even Krishna has it in control. It's the flow of bhakti, the mercy of the internal energy of the Ladini Shakti. Bhakti is Ladini Shakti, Ishwar, control. So when bhakti has free will to appear and to give the mercy to anyone, Kirata, Hunanta, Palinda, Pulkasha, doesn't matter. Lecha, Yavana, high culture Brahmana or no Brahmana, Kirata, Huna, Pulkasha, Yavana, Mlecha. Mlecha means untouchable. So it's not a race. Doesn't belong to a particular country. Mlecha is a habit. Therefore we say somebody who has impure habit, you are Mlecha. Even if you're an Indian, you are Mlecha, if you don't have pure habit. You are un-Aryan, and you are Mlecha. So Mlecha is a bad habit of impurity. And again, Shukadev Goswami says, we can, even the Kirata, Huna, Pulinda, Pulkasha, Shumba, Yavana, Kashadaya, even those aborigines, even these very degraded outcast groups or mentalities can become elevated to the platform of Vaishnava by the association of Vaishnava. This is the power of Prabhu Vishnu, the Supreme Lord's power, because he works not directly on you, he works through the Vaishnava, through the association of devotees. That will change the heart. Nothing else. So therefore, asa trishna, association to the sense objects can only become overcome by associating with devotee, by developing qualities of devotees. And that is devotee quality. Didikshava karunika suridam sarvadehinam achata shatrava shanta sadhava sadhubhushana. So devotee quality is that he is very merciful, he's patient, tolerant, he's equal to everyone, he's not political or partially inclined or see somebody as enemy, somebody as friend. So it has many saintly qualities. And only by the association of devotees and the practice of bhakti, these habits due to our prarabdha karma from previous life becomes removed, becomes washed away. Therefore, nectar of devotion, Rupa Goswami says, prarabdha and ultimately aparabdha. Aparabdha and ultimately even parabdha, the karma that we got due to our past life, taking birth in certain family or nation or with certain habits, become completely washed away by bhakti yoga, by devotional service in the association of devotees. So now we only have to be careful now in the, if we are, maybe we get rid of asa, trishna, and Ridaya Daubalyam, we are very determined now in devotional service. We know the goal. We're fixed in the lotus feet of Spiritual Master and Krishna, simultaneously engaging in fixed up devotional service. Still, we have to be careful about two other anarthas who are even deeper rooted in the conditioned soul. Aparada. Aparada. Aparada means apa, rada. That means deviation from devotion, from active devotional activities. We call it offense. So there's 32 seva aparadas, and there are 10 nama aparadas, and there are 10 nama aparadas and 32 seva aparadas. So this aparada, therefore, offenses to the Vaishnavas, to Guru, to the devotional service, to the holy name, we should avoid by learning it from Shastra, from the Acharyas who are teaching us these Shastras, like Haridas Thakur, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Srila Prabhupada, give so much description how to avoid anartha, give us warning, and also to how to avoid aparada, how to rectify it. And because if we are not rectifying it and we are cultivating aparada as a bad habit, then it's like a wild elephant destruction, destroying a beautiful lotus garden. We're cultivating it nicely, and then let the elephant of madness, of aparada, enter that garden, destroying everything. So aparada will destroy our progress in devotional service. It destroys, or at least stops, the growing of the bhakti plant. So we have to maintain the bhakti plant, cultivate the bhakti plant from aparadas, from offenses, from attempts of sense gratification, of bad association, following bad conducts, of fault-finding mentality, always looking around to who is fault, to see fault, and do you even find pleasure in seeing fault? It's also an aparada. Even if you see fault, what's the use? Therefore, we come here also to Nyaya. Nyaya has three. It's described here. Chalpa, and what is the other one? Vitanda and Vada. These are the three sections or ways of argumenting. And the first two, Chalpa and Vitanda, they're actually not favorable in arguments or in proving something, because it's only I'm right and you're wrong. And it doesn't go about the truth. It only wants to point out that I'm right, so I want to be the right one and you're wrong one. So therefore that's not Krishna. Only the Vada, the argument, but actually from both sides, they're serious about the truth. And they want to find out a solution in a healthy way. Krishna will manifest as the truth and will solve the problem, so that both parties will be satisfied. Win-win. Others are all losers, either loser and winners, or both are losers, ultimately. Because for the others, they're not interested, it's not interest the truth, it's only interest I'm right and you are wrong. And this is cheating. Therefore we are in this material world, we all want to be right and you are the wrong. But the devotee is opposite, he's humble. He's humble. He wants to seek after the truth. Efa Maharaj Parikshit. He was looking after the truth since the beginning of birth. And he found Spiritual Master Shukadev Goswami, sent by Krishna. Both were serious in the truth. And one was speaker and the other one was questioner. Parikshit Maharaj was a sincere questioner, Shukadev Goswami the sincere speaker. Both were perfect and became perfect because of their sincerity, because of their interest in the absolute truth. And therefore the result of both became the same, perfect. Both of them became perfect, they attained the shelter of Krishna. The speaker and the listener. So because both of them are qualified. If both of them are not qualified, then what is the use of speaking? If one only is qualified, the other one is not qualified, then what is the use? So both sides have to be qualified and be sincere, seeking or be interested in the truth. Then Krishna becomes manifested. So when we are going for the truth, for Krishna, Satyam Param Jayate, then we have victory. In the truth is the victory. In the untruth, Asatyam, there's only ignorance, it's only misery, as we already mentioned. And the whole Vedic plan is to come out of this misery, of this cause of misery, ignorance. And from this ignorance, habits are appearing, bad habits, anarthas. And because of these anarthas, based on the ignorance of the wrong conception of life, forgetfulness as an eternal servant of Krishna, where I identify ourselves with this body. Even as devotees sometimes, we are too much on the bodily concept, more interested in bodily concept than in spiritual concepts. And we have very great difficulty to come out of it. And also this weakness of the heart, not enough determination in the service to Krishna and to Spiritual Master. And then of that also appears aparada, because we become puffed up, we become ignorant, we take everything too easy. And then we're seeing fault in others and creating offenses then, knowingly or unknowingly. And that will give a reaction. And that will also hamper or stop the growth of the bhakti plant. And the last one of the anarthas, of the four, three I already told, Ridaya Daubalyam Aparada is Tattva Brahma. It's nothing to do with the creator Brahma. Brahma means bewilderment. B-H-R-A-M-A. Brahma. Tattva Brahma. So Tattva Brahma means bewilderment about the Tattva. Not understanding what is Jiva Tattva, what is Vishnu Tattva, what is Shakti Tattva. We are confusing that, mixing this, and not being clear in our understanding what is what. And in devotional service, we have to learn what is what. What is Vishnu Tattva, what is Jiva Tattva, what is Shakti Tattva. What is asat? What is sat? And so we have to learn about this from the guru and the scriptures. And then if we actually have this education or this knowledge, first jnana and then practicing becomes vijnana, then we can actually come out of this confusion of bewilderment of our mind or intelligence of the mixtures of different tattvas. Then we will have clear understanding what is what, that Vishnu or Krishna is the Supreme Lord, is the Supreme Enjoyer, the Supreme Purusha, and I'm insignificant, small, very tiny, jiva, part and parcel of the Lord, and my duty is to serve Him, to please Him. And if we're actually acting in such a way to please Krishna, then we become happy. Then we become free of the entanglement of the Maya. And that's the ultimate end. The ultimate end of destruction, of all destruction. Bhagavatam gives different descriptions of destructions, pralayas. There's a cosmic pralaya in one day of Brahma. And there's a partial destruction in the one day in the lifetime of Manu. That's the second. And then one in the lifetime of, in the day of Brahma. Then in the lifetime of Brahma, where the whole universe becomes destroyed. In the end of one day of Brahma, the universe becomes dissolved. And then next day when Brahma wakes up, he has to create it again. That's a destruction and the creation again. And the other one is in the Manvantar. During Manvantar, there are 14 Manvantars in a day of Brahma. 14. In total about 500 something. 500,000 Manvantars are in the whole life of Brahma. And in every Manvantar, there's a partial destruction. Bhagavatam says they're all temporary. It's not final. Because after this destruction taking place, again creation takes place. Therefore, these three universal creations, after destruction, become again built up or manifested, again and again. Therefore, Bhagavatam says the Nitya Pralaya, the ultimate destruction, is the destruction of karma. The destruction of karma. Because it is karma what binds us in this material world. But that doesn't mean that we have to stop activity. We only have to learn how to act for the pleasure of Krishna. Again, we are diseased condition, like somebody who is mercury poisoned. So you have to take, you don't have to give up completely. You have to take a minor quantity under the expert direction of physician, of doctor, who tells you how much mercury you should take as a medicine to counteract your poisoning of material existence. So therefore, completely stopping karma is not possible. Because Krishna says, inactivity itself is a sinful. It's sinful. So if we act sinfully or we stop sinful activities and we don't act positively in Krishna consciousness, that's also, we don't become free of material existence. Only if we learn how to engage in Naishkarma, that means in activities will look similar like material activities, like mercury in small quantity is also mercury, but it is not poisoning, it cures your disease. It strengthens your body. Your tejas becomes more strong again through the small amount of mercury. So in the same way, by engaging in devotional service, Nirbanda Krishna Sambandhe Yuktam Vairagya Uchate, by engaging in Krishna karma, in the service of Krishna under the guidance of the spiritual master, will cure our material disease. And that's the only way how the material disease, the repetition of birth, old age, disease, and death actually become vanquished by Krishna karma, by engaging in devotional service. So that's what we're learning here in our practice every day. Therefore, we have temple, we have cars, we have books, we have money, we have electronics, we have so many things what everyone has. But we're using it in Krishna service. And therefore, it is helping us in devotional service. Of course, we can also live without it. If the devotee, he can also live like a renunciate, completely on his own. That's recommended. If you don't have mission, better you live on your own, somewhere in the forest or in the mountains, and chant and meditate. You don't need temples, you don't need cars, electronics. Then it becomes an anartha, it's not needed. But if it is engaged in Krishna service for the sake of spreading Krishna consciousness or cultivating Krishna consciousness in the material world, it is acceptable. Then this kind of atyahara is not over-collecting or over-endeavoring. It is enough to make us balanced and strong in our devotional service. Because we are not on the level that we can engage in completely in transcendental activities, so we need a certain amount of material identification and instruments that we are used to, but instead that we use it for our own sense gratification, we use it in the service of Krishna. Then we should not reject it. In the beginning, when we join, we always think, this is all Maya, and I don't take it in the temple. Then later on we find out, actually your money and all what you had was actually, everything could be engaged in the Krishna service. You should not give it to your friends or give it away as gifts, because you think you don't need it anymore as a devotee in the temple. So therefore, as a devotee, we always learn how to engage the things in the proper way in devotional service. And this way, one gradually become, our activities become purified. And the devotee can overcome this repetition of birth, old age, disease and death by the bhakti yoga process, by sadhana bhakti. And that's the ultimate destruction then. And that destruction is Krishna. Then Krishna will appear and he will take you to him. So therefore Krishna is the beginning. He's the beginning of our life. He's in the middle of our life. That means he is always there in our life, and he is also the end of our life, the goal of our life. So we don't have to be afraid. If we are convinced about this knowledge, we don't have to be afraid, because you understand Krishna is always here. In the beginning, in the middle, and in the end. And in middle means during all the time. From the beginning to the end. In this time, Krishna is also there. There's nothing else. You only have to become conscious about it. That's the practice. And even if you are not conscious and you are endeavor, then Krishna, we will not forget. We maybe forget, but Krishna don't forget. So Krishna will give remembrance, so that we can ultimately attain shelter at his lotus feet. Okay, Hare Krishna. That's the Prabhupada. So any question maybe? Or comment? Okay, Hare Krishna. Srimad Bhagavad Gita Ki Jai.